Hello, hello everybody. How are you? I am Ana Flores. I am the founder and CEO of We All Grow Latina. And as we're waiting for all of you to jump on board today, I just wanted to take a quick moment to say hello, to welcome you all here, to know that we are live streaming right now to both Facebook and to YouTube. And make sure that you drop your comments wherever you're on Facebook or YouTube. We will be able to grab your comments, to grab your questions. And this is going to be a really incredible conversation that I am so grateful to Dash Harris Machado for bringing it forward, for putting it together, and for wanting to share this conversation here in our platform with We All Grow Latina, with We All Grow Amigas, Amigos, and everybody that's joining us here today. So I am not going to take up space. This space is for Dash, for Javier, for Anjali, for Jambiev, and for Evelyn. And I'm going to welcome Dash Harris Machado, who is a multimedia producer and the founder of Afro Latinx Travel and Machetera. Did I get that right?
Yes, correct.
Welcome, Dash. I'm just gonna leave this space to you. And again, super thankful to have you here today with us.
Thank you for having me and us. Good evening, good afternoon. Hello, mis caras lindas y mi gente negra. I am Dash Harris, and I'm joining you from Panama City, Panama, not Florida. We were first. As Anna said, I'm a multimedia producer, doula, co-founder of Afro Latinx Travel, producer of Negro, a docuseries about Latino identity, and co-producer and machetera of the podcast Radio Caña Negra, and co-facilitator of our workshop series, Anti-Blackness in the Latinx Community. Our next workshop is July 24th. And our panel, our beautiful panel. Firstly, Machetera Evelyn, La Repartera, La Única.
One of a kind. Hola, mija, ¿cómo estás?
Pum Pum Short.
Enthusiast.
Red lipstick enthusiast. I'm just gonna introduce the panel, and then we'll do a round robin. Our next is Anjali, my Central American kin.
Brap brap.
Rurgal. Come through. Where's your video? Where's your video, Anjali? What's happening? Let me.
I don't know. Oh, there we go.
Let me shift.
Hello. You.
The sun is setting, so I'm trying to keep the light here.
Amen. Come on, look at this good lighting on this good brown skin. Oh, God. I'm here for it.
So it starts. Our next is Jambiev Williams Comrie, my fellow Panameña, Mama. Oh wait, you got the kids on deck?
I have the what?
The kids on deck.
The kids are on deck, and Nancy's right next to me as always.
The mini machetera, please.
The mini machetera.
First time now. Come on. No paparazzi now. Okay.
Not today.
That matters.
And my ace, Javier, el mismo profe Javier, joining us from the dirty South. Wait, is Texas considered the dirty South or Southwest?
The dirty Southwest. With the whopping combination with everything.
Whopping. Straight from the third coast.
Okay, so it looks like. Looks like, okay, so my husband joined. He doesn't understand anything we're saying. He only speaks Spanish.
But he says
from Cuba. All right, that's enough of that. I'm playing with y'all. I know. Let's get started. I wanted y'all to, well, actually, let me say this before we get to the intros. And very, very plainly and clearly, La Raza Cósmica is a work in white supremacist eugenicist fantasy. Race is a societal construct. There, I said it, so you don't have to. Everyone understands that, and that is precisely the point. We live in real societies which have real consequences for our races. I am going to leave it to Evelyn, Anjali, Javier, and Jean-Biev to intro yourself. They all hold a special place in my heart. They're a gift to the world. I mean, I didn't write this part down because it's coming from the heart. I speak to all of y'all daily. And just to know, y'all have been like my saving graces, you know, during this quarantine time, but just in general, all of you have wonderful gifts and you're just lights to the world. So, Evelyn, you want to start off?
I can never remember to unmute myself. Hi, my name is Evelyn Alvarez and I am from the People's Republic of Guatemala. But I was raised in Brooklyn, People's Republic of Brooklyn, and now I live in the Bronx, so in New York City. I am a fellow machetera, I am a doula, I am a trainer, workshop facilitator, mom, badass, the baddest hype woman on the planet, lover of gold poom poom shorts, and all kind of skin out music. And yeah, I'm excited about this conversation and, you know, and have her up jokes. So if Javier starts laughing, it's probably my fault.
Already it's starting. Pull yourself together. We didn't even get to the first question. Anjali?
I just feel like that Tia voice that you reserved for me, I feel, you know, pero está bien. Hi, my name is Anjali Crawford Gibb. I'm intentionally calling my mom's name tonight, so that's exciting for me. I am from the People's Republic of Brooklyn by way of Limón, Costa Rica. And I just really want to highlight that. Donde quiera que voy, limonense soy. That is my heart. I am an educator. I am a godmommy. I am all the things that we got to be for our kids all the time. I claim myself as a machetera, definitely, always. And I, like I always say, we ain't new to this, we true to this. And I don't know how many ways and how many times to say that, but I will continue to say that and amplify our voices in every space. We're not new to this. We've been Black. BBC, been Black crew, working on the acronym. But we've been Black. And so this work is, it's not a choice. It's not a choice. It is what it is. We do what we do. And we do what we do for baby macheteras fine Yancy. Like, we do what we do so they will be okay and they will be better. And so know this, we're not new to this. We're true to this. We've been here, we stay in here, and we're gonna mash up the place. Gracias.
Period, Pooh.
Jambia.
I like the BBC, the been here. What is it? Born here, been here?
Been Black, Black crew.
Been Black crew. Spelling was never my thing, folks. It was never my thing. So my name is Jean-Pierre Williams Comrie. I live in La República del Bronx, como se reconoce por acá, pero I am from Panama, and I wish I were there right now, because I will be neighbors with Dash if I were in Panama. We will be really close and hanging out. Maybe through our windows. So yes, so I also was born Black. I was never lost in regards to my Blackness. That was never a thought process around who I am or what I was or all any of that kind of stuff. I always knew that I was Black. I'm proud to be Black as well. And that's how I'm raising my children. I'm raising my children and, you know, I come from a very strong Black family as well back home, and we're all very intentionally who we are and very active in what we do. I don't have pum pum shorts on today, but I had them yesterday. So they're going to be in the wash and then it'll be back because it's been hot out here. And with pum pum shorts, you have to wash those things. You can't be like reusing them.
Because some of them are nasty.
No. Exactly.
And just, to mention, we're all doulas, so we know what that is. So
yes, watch,
if you pick any nothing else, take this away. Wash your poom poom shorts.
No, but really, wash your poom poom shorts. Because I don't understand. Uno just wash, you know, and or wash it, pero no. Qué vergüenza. What happened to
intro? So let's get Javier's intro in real fast, and then we'll jump into it.
Hey, what's up, world? It's your boy Javier Wallace, straight out of Austin, Texas, deep down south. Born and raised right here in the capital city, born to an African American black mother and a black Panamanian father. That's me, who I am. I lived in Panama for a while. I tell you that because I'm proud of being black from all sides of the border that I fall on. And it doesn't matter to me what side of the border that I fall on. It all works out the same, because my ancestors labored the same in both places, whether it was in a cotton field in Texas, a sugar plantation in Barbados, or on the Panama Canal digging a ditch in the Republic. It still was a form of exploitation and resistance. And I'm the middle result of that, and hoping to keep that line of legacy moving after me. I do a lot of things that I'm just not gonna run down right now. I do a lot. I think probably most people like find themselves might be interested that I currently am at the tail end of a PhD at the University of Texas at Austin. Something that I hold true to myself close, because on my mother's side, my grandfather was a janitor here. And he was only, because he was black, born in 1922 and UT didn't integrate until 1957. He was on kid number 7. He wasn't able to come, and he always wanted one of us to come here. So I get to stand up here and tear down lecture halls and tell children about themselves in ways that I invoke him, and I do not come through. And if I hurt your feelings, I wish I would say I was sorry, but I'm not. I just feel like that way. So I hope the same is true tonight. I'm glad to share this panel with this amazing group of black women, machateras. I'm here. I'm glad to be in company. I'm here to do as much listening and less talking because of the scope of the panel. And happy to be here. So thank y'all. Thank you, Dash, for organizing. And thank you all, ladies, for allowing me to sit on this panel with y'all this evening.
We love grateful cishet men. We like it. Just to run down, Jambiev is part of Afro Resistance. Please follow them. They're doing amazing work in the US and Latin America, led by Black femmes. Evelyn is the co-founder of Prom King, a organization that collects and distributes clothing for male-identified young people for celebrations. Anjali is a poet, is a wordsmith. Follow her at La Negra Speaks. And Javier is el mismo profe Javier. Like, I mean, el mismo profe Wallace. Like, that's it. I mean, he does Black Austin tours. He's a co-founder of Afrolatinidad Travel. And, you know, get with him. So I'm going to jump into question one. I want to start off with the four bold-faced myths that us Black Latin Americans have always known to be myths, and that we will no longer give most of our energy to. One, in Latin America, it is more class than race. Race and class are inextricably linked thanks to the racial hierarchy of the caste system. Myth two, racism is a US thing. It is not the case in Latin America. We are all mixed, so how can we be racist? Well, we're not all mixed, and many mixtures don't matter in racial hierarchies. Myth three, we never had to identify ourselves by racial terms in Latin America, so I never had to think about my race in my country. One's experience is not universal. Black and indigenous folks have to think about our races wherever we go. And trust, if you did not refer to yourself as Blanco, we were calling you Blanco, if not to your face. And the last one for our panel to address. We hear very often racism is so different in Latin America versus the US. But I'm seeing protests saying, no puedo respirar, las vidas negras importan. In Brazil, las vidas negras importan. Do you think the manifestations of white pathology truly differ in the Latin American Caribbean region than that of the US? And I want to start, actually want to start with Javier, although I know you're going to take your cis het backseat, just because we've been having a lot of conversations around it. And it's just relevant to what we've been, our ongoing conversations.
Most definitely. I really don't even know if this panel has to continue after saying those myths and dispelling them right away. I mean, for me, it's really not too much more to be said beyond what you just stated, Dash, because that's the fact. I do, to answer that question briefly from my point of view, you know, I think there's no difference. I think the only difference that really exists is in the United States, quote unquote, Latinidad or Latinx is a marginalized identity. So therefore, you get placed in this space that's not at the top of the hierarchy. But in your home country, where this Latinidad comes from, and Latino is not the marginalized identity, it works the same way as we think of Anglo-American white supremacy that certain people try to space themselves out from. For me, it's no different. It's no difference. George Washington was in communication with any of his contemporaries in Latin America. Simón Bolívar was in.
Man, he always gets frozen at the clutch. No, Keith. Okay,
subjugate Black people and eliminate Indigenous people. It's the same thing. There's no difference. I mean, and I'm not going to trace down from 1519, from 1492 to 2020, the parallels, but it's the same thing.
What about you, Jambia? And we had a discussion about how the narrative is always Christopher Columbus. His name was Cristobal Colon. 1492, he sailed to the Caribbean, or rather got lost in the Caribbean. So let's get that straight.
I know we my brother and I used to you know, not joke around, but we used to come up with stories around if he had gone the other way and gotten to India instead of Latin America, how would history have been fully and completely different, and what role would we be playing right now? But that didn't happen. So yeah, I feel like these conversations over here are so shallow, right? Are so shallow and so simplistic. And it's the same conversation that all of us here on this panel have been having for over 20 years. So I'm tired of it, right? I'm really tired of it. And I feel like for the listeners out there, one thing that should straighten it out is that Black women have a life expectancy that is between 13 and 15 years less than our white counterparts. And that goes the same with white women from Latin America. It's no different. So here you are, you have four women on this panel and one man. Four of us are going to, hopefully not, right? But four of us, our life expectancy is less than some of the viewers watching us, just because we are Black. And I think that should be enough to center a conversation differently, that we're not playing here. We are actually fighting for our lives. And I've been saying this for over 20 years. How much longer do we have to keep on saying the same thing? And we're getting closer to dying. But now people are jumping on with their life expectancies longer than ours and playing around with it. Like we have time to lose and to play. This is not a game, folks. And I think that has to be like at the center of it. We're dying at the hands of other people. We're dying at the hands of structural and systemic racism. We're dying at the hands of a flawed medical system. We're dying at the hands of post-traumatic syndrome and slave syndrome as well. Like, we are dying because we have inherited all these things caused by white supremacy. Yeah, yo estoy cansada. My body is literally tired. So I'll leave it there.
Angeline.
Yeah, and so I'm going to
to co-sign and to continue what John Viev said, because that in this particular moment, Dash, you know this to be true because we've been texting back and forth. My body is literally falling apart and I'm doing the best I can to hold on in any way that I can because this work is laborious. And anytime things go wrong, that is the immediate moment that Black women are called. And that narrative is the same regardless of whether we're in the United States or whether or not we are in Latin America, the narrative remains the same. And so even when I made this post, I was like, no existimos para mimar. Like, we do not exist to make you feel better, to make every portion of you feel. I don't exist for your white guilt to feel better. I don't exist for those things because I would like to live. But to be clear, my mother passed away at 54, 55, and had a heart attack and died in my arms. So based on when we're looking at my age at this moment, I got maybe 20 years, right? Maybe. So this conversation is tiresome. It is exhausting, but cool. We're gonna have it tonight. Watch it and learn because we're tired. I am always confused, and I'm even more so confused when I hear this narrative about racism being different, white supremacy looking different in Latin America from Afro descendants as well. I am always confused because I don't understand how that narrative continues and is perpetuated. But in about November, I was at an event, Howard and Shirley Campbell Barr was there, and she described it as specifically when referring to Costa Rica as racismo amigable, like friendly racism. And so under the guise of that idea of friendly racism, often Latin Americans, and that's all of us, right? Unfortunately, Afro descendants sometimes are invested in this narrative too. Que era diferente en nuestros países. It was different in our countries. I don't know how that continues to be perpetuated because history does not lie. Prior to 1948, if you were an Afro descendant, you could not leave Limon, Costa Rica. There is nothing friendly about that type of racism. I don't understand. I'm very confused. It is no different from the Jim Crow that happened here in the United States. I don't understand. Right? And so to contextualize 1948, had my mother lived, she would have been around 71, 72. Some of your grandparents are 70s. You gotta, let's think about that. It is no different. And even when we look down just to basic ass numbers, 500 years of enslavement versus four, right? There is no difference. And I'm tired of hearing that narrative. White supremacy is white supremacy wherever we are. And it continues to kill us at exponential rates, as Jean Viev said. It is what it is. Maybe it's more systemic, institutionalized. It's not as violent in our countries. Lies.
No.
But lies, right? But those are the narratives that we continue to perpetuate. And listen, it is exhausting also to be fighting with brown and white and brown Latinos who want to tell you about what your experience is in your home countries and here in the United States. Shut up.
I don't want to cut you off, but I want to just be cognizant of time. I think you can all chime in, right? I think Latin America has done a really good job brainwashing us of the mestizaje myth that you are part of the national fabric, that you are part of patria, that you are Colombian, you're Panamanian, you're Cuban, et cetera, et cetera. Just in lip service, because everything else shows that we're not part of the fabric of society, like Anjali said. That Afro-Costa Ricans, Black Costa Ricans couldn't even leave their departments, couldn't even travel outside of their department until 1948, correct? Evelyn, what are your thoughts on the is Latin American racism different than the US racism?
Honestly, not from my experience. I mean, I've told this story before and you've heard me tell it, but the last time I was in Guatemala, I had a petrifying experience that made me feel no different than when people talk about be careful driving through Mississippi in the United States. I had a moment where I had to, the town that that my mom is from is about 6 hours away from the capital city. So I was with my son on the bus and there was an accident. And because la carretera, the roadway, has only one in and one out, what was supposed to be a 5 hour ride ended up taking 15 hours. And it was 15 hours in the middle of the country with no Wi-Fi, no way of getting anywhere, and nobody giving you information. I was so scared, like, because I knew that I could be victimized if I slept, right? Like, if I felt terribly unsafe, like to the core of my being. Only to get to the capital city and get to the airport, miss my flight, and then have the staff at the airport, white people, turn their backs on me. In the midst of my like frustration, fear, kind of like, and they were basically like, and I'm like, look, my flight leaves at 7. I know I probably missed it. It's 6:40. They were like, you could just wait. If you don't want to pay for a new flight, you could just wait until Wednesday. And it was a Sunday. Yes. They told me that. I just, they were like, ay, usted espera hasta el miércoles así bajan. Turn their backs.
This is in Guatemala. Just to reiterate, this is in
Guatemala. Guatemala City. So, so when people are like, oh, it's different, I'm like, to who? And to who? For who? Right? For whom? When? It was, yeah. So I that has not been my experience. And this happened last year, 2019. So I'm not talking about something that happened many years ago. I'm talking about something that's been very recent. And that when I tell people, other people are like, oh yeah, that happened to me too. Like there's a normalization about this racist practice, which is why people don't see it as racist.
Thank you for that. And thank y'all for sharing your personal stories, because this is personal. This is our lives. This isn't for play. This is not some distant experience that we're talking about. These aren't studies that we conducted on a fellowship. This is our lives. I want to, and we answered this already, but as Anjali, just to reiterate what Anjali said about the Been Black crew, Radio Caña Negra, we say black since birth. How do you feel about this, now these Spanish language and Latin American people, organizations, individuals, TV stations are now flocking to highlight what they say is an awakening. Not my words, because it's not an awakening for us. But will this have traction? And Anjali looks like you, Anjali.
Awakening? Are you referring to the awakening having traction?
Well, the attention at the gay awakening for people who are not us, rather, I should specify.
I know, I'm like.
It will have traction for those who are racially ambiguous, Afro-descendants or Afro-Latin Americans or Afro-Latinos or whatever you want to call it. Will it have traction for those of us on the panel that look like this? Apparently not. And I'm gonna say this because I'm part of many different groups and it's been fascinating, educational groups. It's been fascinating to see people who have said, yeah, I just discovered I was Black 3 years ago. I just discovered I was Black 5 years ago, being given large platforms. Look, the work is the work, and we are not out here looking for platforms, but it is fascinating to me that this awakening is being led by people that don't look anything like nothing like what I understand Afro descendants to look like in Latin America. And any other, if we were back home in our home country, they would not be identified as differently from a mixed race person. So somehow that many racially ambiguous Afro descendants are leading this conversation, I guess it will gain traction because the Western world is fascinated and in love with racial ambiguity. They don't want blackness. They don't want actual factual blackness, like me. They don't want that. So it will gain traction in that sense. Will it gain traction for us? No, absolutely not. Not for those of us that look like us on this panel and who have been here doing the work consistently. So yeah, that's what my face looks like. I'm over it. I'm tired of it. I don't care about you. I don't. Fight your mother, leave me alone. Because like, at the end of the day, some of these people I have taught you that you are Black. But I'm gonna leave it right there because
fight your daddy, not your mama.
Fight whoever is not doing the work.
Because your mama is fighting. Our mamas are fighting and we've been fighting.
Oh, that's all I got for right now. Go ahead. Somebody else pick it up. Y'all know y'all mad too.
Ever, Jambia?
Go ahead, JV.
I'm tired. You know, as I said, it's jumping on the bandwagon. I realize I know all these sayings that are from here, like jumping the bandwagon. I don't even know what that is over there. But what I do know is ¿Qué como?
Afroconvenientes.
Sí, afroconvenientes, sí. But there's a saying, right? Te mastican, pero no te tragan. Right? And that's what's at play right now. And that literally means they will chew you, but they won't swallow you. And the folks that are now jumping on this are the folks that are palatable. We're not palatable, and we know that, especially if we're talking politics, right? Because you do have the very few token ones that have risen, and then they're not really linked to the communities like that. And then they're the examples, right? But then you have the ones that, yes, that just found out. Like I teach, right? So whenever I've seen a black, African descendant, right? Because there's a big distinction, an African descendant Latina woman in one of my classes, I ask them to identify themselves. They always say, "Oh, I'm Dominican, or I'm Puerto Rican, I'm Cuban." I always say, like, "Oh, you don't consider yourself African descendant?" And then there's always a conversation, but they're like 21 or 22 coming into that through mentorship. So it has to be one, it has to be something that starts questioning them in a sense. And I found out I was black probably like at one, maybe two at the most, I think, right? And I don't know how conscious or unconscious it was, but I was called negrita, I was called chomba, I was called fea, bembona, culona. I was called it all. And I'm still called the same things by some of those people and their families that are now identifying as black and then have the audacity to question and challenge. Audacity to not do their due diligence. Who are the elders doing this work? And I'm not one of those elders. I don't wanna even like pretend that I'm one of those elders. There are elders that have died doing this work, centering blackness in the region. The woman that sold the Panamanian flag was a black woman. Where is she in the history? When we're talking early 1900s, the people that are publishing books on our behalf, where were they 5 years ago? Oh, porque ellos sí los tragan. And that's the thing. So I'll keep on being that bitter seed in people's mouths. I'm okay. They're not gonna swallow us. Like, that's a reality. They're just not gonna swallow us. And that's my purpose here. Is not for me to be palatable. My purpose here is for liberation. If you're on that, let's jump on. Let's do it. Let's get it popping. If you are Afro-Latino and you do not look black, but you are invested in black people's liberation, come on, let's do it. If you're mixed race, indigenous, whatever it is, and you're invested in my liberation, in my daughter's liberation, in Evelyn, Angelis, Javier's, Dash, folks that are watching liberation, all Afro-resistance people, people in the region, people in Colombia that are dying, then just jump on it. But don't be looking for me to ask me what my curl number is. God, I don't give a fuck what my curl number is. I have locks. My hair is kinky. It has always been kinky. I don't need a number. If you want to start finding out next the measurement of the lips, to, you know, all that kind of stuff, don't be coming for me. The skin tone, don't be coming for me. Like, I don't have time for that. To have discussions around how I felt when I found out I was black, don't come for that. Don't come for me either. Come for me about liberation, about rights, about reproductive justice, about how our girls are being sexualized at 13, 14 and considered women. Come for me about black Latino boys being incarcerated and treated as adults. Come for me for that. Don't come for me for foolishness. As I said, we are tired.
I want to, I'm coming for you, Angeline. I see it, your hand. But no, go ahead, Angeline. I'm just going to switch, not switch gears, but we're going to talk about what my t-shirt says.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
This is a conversation that Dash has seen happen in live in my classroom, right? At the beginning of every I teach a course in the Afro-Latin diaspora, and I teach it with high school students. And at the beginning of every course, we do a mock exercise where I ask the students to place themselves. This is a Black and Brown population, to place themselves according to what they think access to resources would look like. The Black students, the Afro-descendant students, always go towards the back. And then my students who are racially ambiguous get confused. And then my students who are white Latinos always go towards the front. Right, and these are the conversations that we're having. So look, ultimately, what we're saying at this point is, if you have just discovered that you are Black, no one is angry with you about that. Do that work, figure that out. That's okay. And to be frank, a good percent of us will walk alongside with you. That's not the issue. The issue is you are discovering that you are Black and consuming the space. God damn it, shut up. Because we've been here. We have been here. I don't have time for the foolishness anymore. Shut up. Stop consuming the air. Uno Joaquin, and as uno Joaquin, uno take up the space as soon as you come in. And some of this work is not work that needs to happen in front of everybody. Some of you need to speak to each other about your Blackness and your issues with Africanity, because that don't got shit to do with me. But if you are coming alongside to do the work, in whatever capacity grace can be given to you, mercy and love is extended to you, because we really just want to get free. We do. But in getting free, then we got to tell the bold-faced truth. Stop taking up the space. Stop taking up the air. We are tired. And we are tired in all regions, in all countries. We are tired. No podemos respirar. Ya es suficiente. Stop taking up the space.
I feel like I'm getting scolded, and I'm not even
my job. I don't think that there's much left to say. I too am exhausted, and you know what? Honestly, I feel offended. I feel deeply hurt and offended. That's another emotion that comes up for me. I feel deep disappointment. I feel like, why are these people who just discovered their Blackness is established in 2018, how do they get priority in being in staffing educational spaces about Afro-Latinidad or
just learned.
Or acting like things that we have lived with and managed and honored are all of a sudden like, oh my gosh, I have to get my resource fixed. Like, there's people out here that have been happy with their naps for a long time, right? Like, they just been happy with naps, and naps are life. And that has been really sexy. I've been seasoning my food since the beginning of time, right? I've always known how to dance and have food, right? And all the things. So it's like this idea that's, I feel like sometimes they act as if you're supposed to be grateful that they decided to acknowledge you. So there's a level of condescension, like, oh, well, I mean, I am Afro-Latin. Okay, and? Right? So it's difficult because I don't know whether it's for performance, because it's like a popular thing, and so all the cool kids want to have some sort of energy, or if it's something that you're really trying to do the work. And so the jury is still out, right? Another US-based comment, right, Genevieve? The jury is still out on whether that's believable over the long haul, until you are willing to decenter yourself, because they'll be like, échense pa un lado, venimos nosotros. And you'll be like, I've been here my whole life. So I don't believe, I personally don't believe it yet. I think that I will go on record as saying that if your Afro-Latinidad has been established, if it's not older than the Trump presidency, I still need to. I don't believe it yet.
We need the receipt.
I don't trust it. And sorry, Javier, but I just have one little thing. Well, it's not a little, but you know, a young person joined this like work group that I was on around Afrolatinidad, and then when it was time to present, fully dropped the ball. And when we debriefed, it was like, I didn't feel comfortable. And we were like, but this is what you signed up for. And her thing was, I'm still exploring. But she didn't say that when she first came in. So there was also like a violation of trust. And this is what there is. There is a violation of trust based on who you're saying that you are versus who you really are. And there's a lot there, right? Because I can't jump in. Like, yes, when you're pregnant, you're pregnant. But I can't be pretending that I have a teenager and I'm carrying my first baby and giving like advice about teenage years and motherhood. And then people find out, oh no, this is gonna be her first baby. Like those things don't correlate. I don't know if that's a good example or not, but you can't be pretending that you're somebody and you have this experience when you're just coming into your Blackness. And I think everybody and distance and migration, and there's a lot of different factors that alienate people from who they are and sadly make people's heritage and racial identity hidden from Latin America. You know, part of it is the history of racism and mestizaje makes older folks sometimes embarrassed to be who they are, so then their children don't know who they are. And it's okay if you're coming into your Blackness, that's okay, but stay in your lane. Stay in, I'm coming into my Blackness lane. Let me see what's out here, because right last week before I came into my Blackness, I was talking shit about Black folk. I was talking shit about Black folk. The amount of Latina women that are Afro-Latina now that just came into their Blackness and are sitting on panels about their experience and not being honest. Like, if you're going to sit on a panel, be honest. Say it. Own it. I think that is more productive to everybody. To everybody. Than lying about you've always been Black and Latina. No, they don't say Black. They say Afro-Latina, right?
That's my next thing.
Like, just be honest. I would appreciate the honesty and be able to work with you. And Angela, you said that we would walk next to you. I'm not walking next to you. You're walking next to me. You're walking next to me.
Womp.
Because I've been walking. This concrete floor has busted my feet. I've been walking while you've been sitting there, like, looking at me, looking crazy. And now you want to walk and you have nice little flip-flops on? No. No. And Birkenstocks. No.
Don't talk to the Birkenstocks, though. Wait! Look at Brando! Yo!
I'm trying to hold it together. I'm trying to protect you today. Hit that horn again.
Have you had, So Javier, I'm going to have you answer this next question, which is, it's all connected. You know, all of these themes are connected. There's a little machetera, probably bored of these conversations at 7 years old already. Like, she's like, okay, another liberation.
But they sit through it voluntarily. She's not, you know, she's not going to pay to be here. She's hanging out with her mama.
So as you see, my shirt, Afro means Black. It's by a fellow Black Boricua, Daniel Morales Armstrong. At the bottom, it has our hashtag, Las Vidas Negras Importan, things that we've been saying forever. AOC recently said Latinos are Black. And as my shirt says, Afro means Black. All of us on the panel understand that the term Afro-descendant was championed in the 2001 Durban Conference, identifying Afro-descendants as a specific victim group still facing consequences of the transatlantic slave trade. It's a tool in global solidarity and Afro descendants and political power and recognition within our various countries, such as quantifying us on our censuses, like Mexico is doing, like Peru did, like Panama is putting the Afro descendant component after, what, 60 plus years of it not being on the census. Javier and I had a convo where we said we
not both. Training people properly.
Huh?
And not training people properly about how to do the census.
Mm-hmm. Salient point. Javier and I had a convo where we said we're at the brink of just only using the term Black Latinx since Afro has been co-opted. And Jean-Viev, you make the distinction between non-Black Afro-Latinxes and Black Afro-Latinxes. In these times, has Afro been used to actually mean Black within the scope of the U.S. Latinidad conversation? Or is it, what I've been seeing is it's a way to decenter Blackness, to say I am everything but Black, to get the cool points or be Black for pay, right? But not actually be invested or even claim it. Javier, you had a lot of strong opinions on that. I'm gonna have you start with those responses.
Yeah, I mean, being totally honest, like, it's very hard that you hear me now even say Latino, Latinx, any of that. Not even connected to Afro, not Black, because, like, I'm over it. And I was giving everybody their space to be able to talk in the previous question. But in truth, I have, like that's how over it I am. And I have a lot to say on a lot of different things. But I don't even talk about it anymore, because what I know about life so far and how I experienced life being a Black person in Texas and a Black person in Panama, it makes me not even want to invoke this idea of Latinidad in any sense, because it couldn't save me at all. It didn't save me in Texas, and it didn't save me in Panama looking down the barrels of police weapons. It didn't save me. So for me, it's almost baseless. And I understand conversations about race change. Like, that's why we have them. They evolve, right? Like, that same thing happened with African Americans in the United States. You know, we're not an African American today because that's what we woke up and wanted to be called when slavery was abolished in 1865, right? It was Negro colored. We toggled with Afro-Saxon for one point in time. Like, it's an evolving conversation, but I think in reference to the Durban conference, that something needed to be happened. I think the unintended consequence, from my perspective, is that we still gave people an escape route from Blackness. We normalized, we acted like, you know, we made Afro and Negro be two different things. And those of us who couldn't attach to Afro and stayed Negro continue to receive the same negative consequences that have always been attached to Negro. So I think the conversation, but Afrodescendiente and Negro, it has to move forward to the point of them meaning the same exact thing. And it's like Jean-Viev said, if you are just understanding you're Black and claiming African-Native, that's cool. And I'm all for it. But, you know, like, you can't occupy the space, like Angelique said. And for me, I'm over it, because I grew up in Texas. I didn't grow up in New York. Like, there wasn't a lot of different Afro-Latin people around me. No, I grew up in Texas, right? This is a place where you Black, white, and Mexican, period. You know what I mean? And if you like me, you Black Mexican. That's it. It ain't nothing else to it. That's what it is. You know, so for me, I haven't had to really toggle with too many different things. And I'm a teacher, right? So I meet people where they at, but you got to meet where I'm at too. So you can be Afro, you can be Afro Latino, but if you say that in my scope, you saying you're Black. And if you're saying you're Black, you're Afro Latino. I don't even use that. You got to hear me talk now. I'll be like, when they talk to me about Afro Latino travel, yes, we curate travel to predominantly Spanish speaking countries, somewhere located in Central or South America. I don't even say Latin America no more, because I think it's BS. Because if you ask my grandfather in Panama, who's in his 90s right now, if he was Latino, he's spitting your face, I know no Spanish, man. And I'm like, yeah, Hey, hello, Don Pania. I said, what? So if you 100, you almost older than the Republic. What business I got talking about? I'm Latino. And this man, I don't know Spanish man them, Spanish man foolish, Spanish man that. And I mean, I got to trouble the things that he says, right, in a certain aspect. Because, and I put it in how he's experienced the world as a Black person. But for me, Afro means Black. And if we have to have the conversation, which one is supposed to mean which, I'm going with Negro. Punto y final. ¿Cómo se dice that in Espanol?
Right. Nah, but for real, Negra. And that's it. Punto final. Right? Like, I use Afro-Latino because it is a framework that people are using to understand things. Heck, I use it for my students. I am an educator. I meet you where you're at. If it is how you understand that I am a Afro-descendant from Latin America, cool. But that is the only usefulness that the phrase has for me. I don't want it. I don't need it. You can keep it. Hold that. When you call my name, nada morena, no. Call me Negra all day, every day, and twice on Sunday. Negra. That's it. Punto final. Because there is nothing that is negatable about my Blackness. I'm not going to go down that road. But there is nothing that is negatable about my Blackness. And there is nothing that is negatable about my Africanity. It is everything. It is in the food. Like, John Hill has been following my page for the past couple weeks. And the food that I have been posting is African as fuck. Because you know what? I just need home. Like, I need home. And I don't know how else to say that to you. And I don't think that if you don't understand that fundamentally, then actually excuse yourself from Afro-Latino. If you cannot say negro or negra, if you are uncomfortable saying it, then you must remove yourself from the conversation of Afro-Latino, Afro-Descendiente. I don't care what. Leave. This is not your party. You are not welcome here. I said what I said.
Yes. To all of that, and just to reiterate, AOC saying Latinos are Black is erasing actual Black Latinos and actual Latinos who are not Black. We're not all Black. We're not all white. We're not all Asian. We have different ancestries and life trajectories based on how we are racialized in our home countries. Ev, did you want to chime in?
Nah, I think y'all out here mic dropping, like, just really recognizing it's Black or I'm Black, y'all. Blackity Black. Black, but I love Black. I've always appreciated Black, which is why I struggle with, I think Afro-Latino is a term that other people use to define you, to recognize like, oh, okay, this person is from a specific region, but it's not the way that I typically identify or describe myself, because I think I also align myself with Blackness globally, right? So it's not just local, it's not just regional Blackness, but like, you know, I run this joke all the time that when I go somewhere, I'm always like, where do they sell fried fish? Because where I can find fried fish, I find Black people, right? And so wherever I go, and it's always like, well, that may not be the neighborhood that you really want to go to. This is, and I'm like, that's exactly where I want to go, because that's where I know I'm going to find Black people. And it doesn't just happen anywhere I go. Like, that's where it is, you know? So I love Black, and I'm always cracking up when somebody defines themselves or they introduce themselves and they say, oh, I'm Afro-Latino. I'm like, oh, you're Black. And they're like, oh, I'm Afro-Latino. Like, oh, so you don't want to say Black. Gotcha. So you want the rhythm, but not the blues. All right. Got it.
Exactly. Language and location matters. Our ancestors were not slaves, they were enslaved, and I beat this. I will die on that hill. This centers their humanity, and by extension, our very own humanity. With this, the responsibility is then placed on the person who did the crimes, the person enslaving. Now, another term that y'all know I love is this ridiculous term, white passing. A term that has absolutely no translation in the Spanish language, a term that nobody in Latin America uses. Instead, we opt for blanco when we're talking about white people. We say blanco, and let's not pretend like we don't use these words on a daily basis. Negro, jabao, mulato, mestizo, sambo, blanco, rabi blanco in Panama, which rabi blanco in Panama is the moneyed white classes. So let's stop, cut it out, cut the crap. Evelyn always says ubícate, because white Latinos are refusing to locate themselves in whiteness. locate yourself in whiteness. U.S. Anglo is not the only white to exist. And in thinking about Spain and Portugal being in Europe, the white colonizers and their white criollo children who still have maintained power in Latin America, controlling politics, media, everything else, the blanqueamiento eugenics campaigns of the 1800s, the 1900s to intentionally whiten Latin America with Europeans, including Nazis and former US Confederate human traffickers. What are white Latinos tasked with?
Accepting their whiteness. That's number one. They white. If you white, you white. They need to, I will maintain that they need to do the work to fix white people so that they don't feel like, oh, well, I can't do it. Like, just accept it. If you white and you Mexican, you a white Mexican. You're not white passing. Like, I don't, what, if y'all know that something is wrong with whiteness to the point that you want to evade it, but you want all the benefits, then you got to do some work to be able to heal your people so that the harm is not caused where you're trying to run away from it.
And right? We also have to say that you can be mixed and white. I mean, just like we, all of us would be mestizo in Latin America, but everyone's going to look at us crazy if we say we're mestizo. Just like you could be mixed and black, you could be mixed and white. And it's just ridiculous, the notion. And I'm sorry if I interrupted, Ev, like continue, but I want Javier to comment on the white passing, because white passing means something specific in the U.S. context for African Americans.
And it's offensive for them to take that because they don't run the risks. They're people who had to pass. Like I don't understand. But sorry, Javier. Go ahead.
No. You know I love it. I was waiting for you to hit the horn one time. But not for
you
real.
You know I'm waiting for you, so I can hit the horn. It's your turn.
Dale. You know, but it's like it's offensive. It's disgusting, in my honest opinion, when I hear white passing, because I know like in the U.S. context, which we use this word white passing Latino, you know, it's co-opted off of the factual things that primarily African-American or black people had to do, which I would go out and argue is probably very similar in these Latin American countries, is to avoid racialized terror. To avoid racialized violence, to have access to a dignified life, being the product more than likely of a parent, a mother who has been sexually violated and abused over generations to the point that this person comes out with probably the majority of the ancestry that person has, which is like European, white European ancestry, but still is tagged with being negro, still is tagged with being negro. Colored, slave, enslaved, black, they have to strategically place themselves in places to have a dignified life. And they would never be like, hello, my name is Javier and I am a white passing Negro. The fuck? What? You might as well brought your own noose to hang yourself with. You know what I mean? Like, why are you coming in here telling us that? Because you would never say it, because it was a strategy to be able to have a dignified life and access opportunities that they would not be able to access had they continued to stay black. And that's the disgusting part for me, is that it's used completely out of context. And again, it ends up being violent to the people who are still descendants of people who had to pass, who never revealed that they had this ancestry, because it was detrimental to their livelihoods and their descendants. So when you say that, you invoking all of those people who were violently pushed into passing. And it can't just, you can't just use that language. And I think that's the dangerous part. It's completely out of context, 100%.
Listen, if you cross a border and you are suddenly white passing, then I am thoroughly confused. Because I don't understand how you left your country and you were white in your country and now you reach here and you're not white no more. Is all that one work? Like, how does that work? That's the reality of the situation is this. If you're white in your home country of Latin America, you are white here. In a group that I was in, an educational group for Afro-Latinos, a woman said, I am a white passing Afro-Latina.
What?
And I had to fight.
set myself not to screenshot it and blast her because I was like, you know what? And so I had to debate myself that day if I was going to engage. And I did not because I was tired. I sat with it so long because I'm like, what in heaven's name is a white passing Afro-Latina? Help me understand. And you know what a white passing Afro-Latina is? I'm going to tell you what it is. Dash, I don't remember who that girl is, but the one who curled up her hair and went to go to a casting call talking about I'm going to be Afro-Latina, that has to be, because if you are, again, Afro-conveniente, right? I'm actually flabbergasted even as I'm speaking because I do not comprehend. Own your shit. You are white. It is what it is. You may have African roots somewhere, Afro descendancy, someplace, but your lived experience is that of a white person with all of the privileges. Cut it out. Because you do not in any way, shape, or form have the same lived experience as anyone on this panel. If all five of us were in a car together and got pulled over, no one cares what type of black person we are.
I'm Panamanian.
No one cares that I am Costa Rican. No one cares that I am Limonense. No one cares though. Like, no, we're just, okay, so y'all niggas with accents. Cool, no problem.
Yeah, this always makes me like, folks that get called, at least in the context of Panama, Colombia, Venezuela, I believe Brazil, I don't think it's much different in the other countries, right? Folks that call themselves white there, it's fully linked to race and class, right? And I fully understand that. But then there's a whole other leap of people that are still white, but they don't enjoy that the class benefit, but they enjoy a lot of the privileges, right? Unspoken ones and some spoken ones, because they know who is not white, because they're the ones that call us names and bully us in schools and throw stuff on. I've had people, kids spit from a private school bus as I'm walking on the sidewalk
in Panama, just to make that clear.
In Panama, from like one of those uppity Catholic schools. So they know who is not white, but they're not identifying themselves as white because white is a dominant culture. So why do they have to identify as white? But then they come and they migrate somewhere else in the United States. And over here, the blancos from here, from this country, the same way that U.S. blancos go and, let me turn on this light, sorry. The same way that the blancos from here go to our countries, and then the blanquitas over there want to get with the blanquitos from here, right? So, and some blanquitos from here really like that, but then their families don't accept it because they're from another country. And that's where the ethnic piece comes in. So when they move here, the blanquito Americans, the white Americans are like, no, 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 we don't know where their money's from. So be careful with them. And you don't know their family and this and that and from another country. But whiteness is whiteness. So they still manage and navigate themselves. So that white woman or white man will become the other in their house. But they're still all white. The difference is that they have this different ethnic relationship. Oh, but now they're victims. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. They heard me speak Spanish, and then they say that they don't understand how I say. But that has nothing to do with your race. Get over it. Get over it. That has nothing. Your ethnic identity has nothing to do with your race. So you can be white and enjoy all the privileges of whiteness and looking for your white man in the Hamptons. Because if I go to the Hamptons, I'll be the maid. I will be considered like the maid and my kids, the little maids. because there's no grace for Black children either.
And that was a quote said by a Brazilian, a white Brazilian kid, saw a Black Brazilian kid and said, look, mom, a little maid.
Yeah. Yeah. And we were little maids when we were enslaved in our countries of origin too. And when I think, I have that very present because when I think of my daughter who's now 7, there are slaves that are cleaning houses at 7. And they looked like us. And they were cleaning the Blanquita's houses that call themselves white passing. And then you have another, I'm going to throw a curveball because you have another category. And Helly, I know you're going to laugh at this one. It's called the Afro Blancos. And the Afro Blancos are those that are academia.
That's my next question, Javier. Why are you like
the what?
That's the next theme, the Afro Blancos.
The Afro Blancos, baby. Yeah, baby.
We tired of y'all too.
So we get called on to be I don't do LASA anymore, Latin American Studies Association. I don't do them anymore. I don't fuck with them. Because they always be wanting me to sit on panels with white people that are going to inform the audience about things that happen in Latin America. And then when I correct them, they're like, I have a PhD, bitch. And I'm like, well, I know, but I'm Black.
I want that. Because that's the next topic.
Oh,
and yeah. No.
I go on. You heard me. Like, that's my next question, so I kept on going.
I just want to say, people watching, we're going to go a little bit over. It's been a little bit over an hour, but we're going to go a little bit longer, and then we're going to have Q&A. So if you got to leave, you got to leave. But, I mean, you should stay. You should stay. Yeah. So the next topic, and I'm going to start. This is about you, Janvia, but I want Janvia and Evelyn to chime in because we've been talking about this for the past week. Two extremely ahistorical white Latin American men recently did two opinion pieces on New York Times about Black Latin America. Jorge Ramos catapulted out of his lane, writing that racism is, quote, a hard conversation for the Latino community, end quote. He actually used John Viev's quotes in the article without permission and mentioned his co-anchor, effervescent Black Colombian journalist, Ilia Calderon, citing her book, My Time to Speak. And instead of actually allowing space for either Ilia or John Viev to actually speak for themselves, he decided to speak for them. Additionally, a white professor, Latin Institute, chose to erase the diligent and dangerous work of millions of Black Latin Americans over 5 centuries. And he spoke out of turn again, and I quote, Latin America is ready for its Black lives reckoning. In Latin America, the sense of moral outrage is far less widespread. While the war on drugs is a clear driver of violence in Latin America, it is harder to speak of a causal relationship between racism and police brutality. Many officers are themselves Black and brown, end quote. So we can't even be censored in Blackness. And newsflash, you don't have to be specifically white to be anti-Black. Anyone can be anti-Black, especially within these white power systems where we internalize white values. And law enforcement, they're trained to be hyper-vigilant and hyper-violent with Black people. Not to mention that this professor is a white Brazilian and the Brazilian police force is controlled by whites. So I want Ev to chime in. Janvier, of course, because Jorge used your intellectual property without your permission. Yet again, this co-opting and the theft of Black women's thoughts and ingenious or ingenuity. And Javier, your experience with the police in Panama specifically.
These people are some real intelligent tontos, right? Like, I have, you know, obviously, you know that we talk about this all the time during our workshops hosted and facilitated by Radio Caña Negra. I'm amazed at how people can claim inclusivity and still remain attached to exclusivity. Right? That they'll be like, we talking about you, but let me be the one to talk. Right? The information is better handled from one person or from me. Right? These types of beliefs. And just like, you know, Anjali said earlier, just the constant centering of yourself in things that you know you don't know how to do. It's like a podiatrist talking about, let me do brain surgery. Stop your madness right now. Just be willing to share the mic or offer it to somebody who's better equipped. You ain't got the range, player. You ain't got the range.
Or the lived experience, just based off of that.
The range comes from the lived experience. I don't know if y'all ever seen that like Viola Davis meme where she just pick up her bag and go. When I hear some of this foolishness, that's exactly what I'd be wanting to do. Just pick up my bag and just be like, you know what? I ain't got time for these raggedy mofos. You just got to live your black ass best life, because that's what they really mad at. They mad that you're mad at, that you're not mad at being black, is what I have really come to that conclusion. That somehow every effort that they've made to try to make people feel bad about their blackness in any border has not worked. And so now they have to try to find new ways to take away your joy, because black joy and black happiness is ultra resistance.
A few people are confused in the comments. Again, not paying attention to what we're saying. They're asking, what are Afro Blancos? So we're repeating what we just said. Please pay attention if you're still confused, because this is also anti-blackness, forcing us to continuously explain ourselves and continuously do repeat labor. And Afro Blancos is a term John Viev said as a tongue in cheek, more so.
Correct.
So please, if you're confused, please pay attention.
Yeah, so a few black folk that are in that, you know, that are in academia and some circles say Afro Blancos for the white scholars that have done research throughout Latin America and become experts on issues, and so much that they feel the right to tell you that you're wrong about your experience, even though you have lived in the flesh experience. They have spent and invested time doing research on this, and we need to listen and appreciate that they have spent their mom and dad's money and some scholarship money to do this research, and we should be appreciative of the book that has all this knowledge, because the knowledge coming from our mouth is not real. And, you know, I should say for the folks that are asking, you know, this is part of it too. The written word sometimes is more valued than the experience. And we have to
be that's my value. White supremacy
culture.
Exactly. And we have to start really questioning why that is, that we're not listening to people, right? But yes, so white folks are talking about Afro-Brazilians. So those are the Afro-Blancs, the ones that speak with authority, right? The folks that at Harvard, the Afro-Latino Research Center, Afro-Blancos, they
full
are
of white.
All white, all Afro-Blancos. They they sit at the table.
I want to explain to you about your own narrative, right? And then profit off of it, take the resources, fund back their shit, and you are still left tattered and torn with your narrative not being told in the ways that it needs to be. Y'all, cut that shit out.
Oh, he has a personal story about that, a couple, but he submitted for a journal about his experience of police brutality in Panama and was rejected. And the person said, that sounds more like a journal entry, a diary entry, not peer-reviewed work. And it's because they don't have the range. How are you going to peer-review my life? Go ahead, Javi.
No, you know, I'm in academia now, and it's not something that I ever really wanted to do. And, you know, like now that I'm a college student again and not playing football like I was the first go around, and I interact with students, I see like those students who are destined to become scholars. Like they're the ones who are at 17 talking to me about critical race theory, and I'm still trying to figure it out at 32. But you like figure out who those young people are easy. They're like, dang, I guess that's what it's like to become a career scholar. But that never was my trajectory. Like I just fell into this academic thing. It just was the logical next step. And I have to say for me, academia hasn't been a violent space as it can be because how I entered into academia. I know my experiences are very, very divergent from many other Black people from predominantly Spanish-speaking countries who come into academia because the people who surround me, who brought me into the program, make me okay and feel okay about being Black and let me write what I want to write and speak from my position. And I think, and I know a shameless plug at this point for UT Austin, like those people who surround me, like they've been like, no, you do you. You talk about that because we don't have that experience. You talk about that. And they were like, well, you know, with that you talk about that. And this is what my advisor told me. He's like, you need, he read my piece, the one I submitted. And he was like, no. You need to put your positionality. You need to tell them who you are so that they will give you, what you're saying will be validated. Cause I'm talking about like the violent treatment of Black men in Panama. And like, that needs to be there. And I'm like, that's crazy, but I understand why it needs to be there. And so staring down the guns of the police officers, who lema es proteger y servir. That informed how I think about the scholarship. My relationship with these young people that live in Curundu, a very marginalized area, a very predominantly Black area of Panama City, live in Colón, that informed the way I think. That informed the way they interact with me. So when I sit down and write, I write like that. And I say those things because that's how I felt those things. But then when somebody tells me that being victimized by police brutality is more of a personal diary entry than anything that validates scholarship is racialized violence. And they keep us from making the spaces that we have to. I don't mean to say gratefully. I have an affiliation with this institute, Afrolatin and Harvard, because I write for me. and I write for me, and I'm not gonna change it. And when I go into those spaces, it's important that I tell them that you might have studied this since you were that scholar coming up that I see that 17. But this, what I'm talking about, was nothing that I ever wanted to write about. It's something that I felt when they pulled me off the bus. It was something that I felt when the young people came here to play basketball and y'all sent them home. Y'all took away everything, their whole idea to move forward in life. I see that. I saw that. I lived that. So that's what I'm going to write about. But academia and those Afro-Blancos, they do have the power to write about us without actually caring about us. And that's one of the most conflicting things that I think about in academia, because I know I'm going to publish this stuff, these things that I'm talking about, and it's probably going to launch my career super far. But I might make a lot of money too, hopefully. Please.
Wait a minute.
Y'all know some numbers to play. But I'm going to make a lot of
money. I got five on it.
Rayo Caña Negra is going to come up with a journal. We're going to get this published. It's coming.
Right. We're publishing your journal. It's coming.
Way out here.
How do you give back? How do you give back to those people you've taken so much from? Like, it burns me to the inside. If one of these young people that I write about right now, if they write me and they say they need anything, I don't ask myself, Ross, why are they begging me for money? I'm like, hell, I went and begged them for their story. And I'm going to make a lot of money off of this story. So if you need $50, tell me your Western Union. Give me your passport number. Let me go down there and give you the $50. Now, hell, that might not be ethical. That ain't my business. That ain't my business.
White ethics, though. White ethics. This is our family. This is our life. This is our community.
Yeah, I don't go with
that. To be clear, any ethic that we try to put to them that is associated with whiteness will never get us to where we need to be. So yeah, we're gonna do what we're gonna do to make sure that we eat, that we have what we need by any fucking means necessary. I don't got time for y'all. Y'all here killing us and mad about the ways that we do things.
And when we eat, they eat. I think that's another part of it, right? Even the push into Afrolatinidad is steeped in whiteness in a way that Black people don't do. So, right, we ain't like that. So this kind of like aggressive push into like, oh, I'm gonna tell you who I am, and in fact, I'm gonna tell you who you are and what you're experiencing and what you're not. We don't roll like that. So that shows me how much you're not even part of this community and that you don't even respect it to respect what it is, how it is that we do things.
And I think that that's so important to highlight because we don't push aggressively. A lot of what happens, and this is across the Afro diaspora, a lot of what we do, we move in silence. Things just happen because they need to happen, right? No one is going to discuss that you don't have money for your lights. Someone is going to come over, there's going to be an envelope, the lights are going to get put on. That's it. Punto final. We're not out here pushing aggressively for Afro blancos, Afro convenientes. You want to take, and again, it's a U.S. phrase, but you want the rhythm, but you don't want the blues. And to be clear, I also want to push back a little bit, not push back, I also want to just highlight this. Everything ain't blues. There's good joy, there's good happiness, there's good, but come out of our spaces for when we are celebrating in the ways that we know how. When we are cackling about Blackness, we are cackling about Africanity, about our shit, it is annoying for you to be present. You can, like, go away. Go away. I'm tired. All I want right now.
The pen and paper, like,
taking notes about, like, I'm gonna let it go. But one of the things that is fascinating to me is that I can jump from a barbecue up the block singing Frankie Beverly. The next one is Barris Hammond. And the next one is Ismael Rivera. And I am not confused by anything that happened. I have been singing Tanto Boom, Esa Chica Me Vacila, my whole life, as well as You Ain't Nothing But a Teaser. Like, so I don't know. Like, y'all out here taking notes. I'm not taking no notes. And I knew when to turn which one off and on. If we was in Brooklyn, and I needed to be Brooklyn, what up, though? We good. Yo, as soon as I hit Flatbush, whopping, hit the Bronx, girl, you had to know what to do. But the thing is, we were always aware of each other's Blackness because we are actual, factual kin. We are not Johnny come lately. I am not confused by fufu because I have been eating fufu my whole life. I turn meal. You put the time, you cook it together. That's it. Because also, that is something that we also have to highlight. When we say that we are not new to this, but we are true to this, we are saying that we have always been kin. We have always been family. I don't know any other way to move. I am not saying that we don't have issues and discord as family. The fuck we do. But, and I remember, Dash, you told this story. You told this story, and you told my class it was about whether or not Yuko would save a Afro American or a white Cuban. And you was like, an African American. Why? Because we can. Like, we're not confused. And if you are confused, I need you to, as Genevieve said, I need you to come and walk in silence. Because some of y'all, no one ever taught you to stop speaking when big people are speaking. And I'm not shutting up children's voices. I'm not saying that. I'm not shutting up children's voices. Don't ever say that. Let the children them talk. But what I mean is,
they're ready to brag. They're ready. They're in the wings waiting.
Right. Yeah. Like, two things. When you're new, like, listen to someone else.
So no Birkenstocks and shh.
Wait, but I like the little Birkenstocks.
I wear Birkenstocks too. But my thing is, like, don't be jumping up. And I've been walking bare feet for all these years, and my foot are busted from the concrete pebbles. And you have been all your life with these comfy shoes, and now you're like, we're all together. No.
Actually, they were in the car. They were in the car, Jumbia. They were in the car.
But and I just want to say this about the Birkenstocks. They look like the biker shorts. Okay, yeah, see, okay.
No, I love my little Birkenstocks.
Jugando. I know, baby. I know.
So the
like, can we just celebrate that they're back in style? Like, okay, just me? Okay.
So the last point, and we're running over. So if anyone needs to leave, that's fine, but you should stay. Just highlighting and lifting up voices and people who, specifically Black femmes, Black women, Black Latinas who have been doing the work and have been killed for doing the work in Latin America. We're talking about Francia Marquez, Black Colombian woman who escaped an assassination attempt, which is in the legacy, this ongoing practice of targeting and killing Black social leaders in Colombia, this ongoing practice of illegally imprisoning Black Latin American freedom fighters. Miriam Miranda, who was abused, violated. She's alive and well. She's there continuously doing the work. But we have people, white people, at the Afro-Latin Institute at Harvard sitting in their air-conditioned offices talking about Latin Americans are ready for a reckoning with Black Lives Matter. Who are you speaking about? How dare you? Who are you speaking about? Who are you speaking to? Let's make that very clear. The ongoing work of Black women, specifically, because we're the ones getting killed and targeted and maimed and abused, speaking out for everyone. And this is globally. This ain't new. At the same time that we're demanding justice for Breonna Taylor, a few weeks after Breonna Taylor was murdered in her bed, a 14-year-old Black Brazilian boy was shot in his back in his house too. At the same time that we're talking about Black people getting killed in front of their house, while they're driving, while they're in school, wherever, we had Anderson Arboleda in Colombia that was tear gassed and beat till he died the next day in Colombia. So we're demanding justice for Black people, period. If I'm gonna take questions from the viewers now, so we're gonna open for Q&A.
I have something to say really fast. Something to celebrate. Yeah. Everyone, get your thing ready. So the Afro-Latino Diaspora's book series wants to publish Javier Wallace when he's ready.
Woo! All right, thank you. Thank you so much. I saw that. That's the chat.
So make sure you follow up.
That's what Dr. Natasha Gordon Chippenberry. I have a good relationship with her. She's definitely is a Costa Rican. Y'all, you know Costa Rica. She's from Costa Rica. Lives in Costa Rica now, and does a lot of work of revising, reconstructing Black history that's always been there, but that's been hidden. And I think that's the work, like some of the work that needs to be done. And I mean, and I appreciate her to the nth degree because she does a lot of work with my work. Like, I'll send her my stuff. And she's one of those people that I say that have embraced me saying what I want to say and using my experiences to lead what I say, because I'm pretty sure people like her and like everybody here have had their, and she's from Brooklyn too, y'all. She's one of y'all. She's one of y'all.
It's only right. It's only right.
She's one of y'all. But I think that's what.
You said that was my auntie. Got it. Got it. Hola, tía, ¿cómo estás? I'll be in Limón después de COVID.
Yeah, she the one that put me on game about Limón, for real, for real. If we want to be honest, like, she came in there, blew all our little, we took them students in UT, blew all their little minds. She was like, what did your mama Tico ask you about Limón? She said, y'all probably cousins. You know everybody down there related. Yeah. Hey. Are there any questions?
So I just, the floor is open for any of the viewers to ask questions. You can find us at Radio Caña Negra or Radio Cana Negra. Radio Cana Negra. In English, Afro Resistance, One Austin Tours.
What about that translation? That was a
God, Radio Cana Negra. We are doing an anti-Blackness in the Latinx community on July 24th. So follow us on Facebook for that information. Follow Afrolatinx Travel or Afrolatino Travel on Instagram. Our website is afrolatinxtravel.com. And just keep, stay attuned. Stay attuned. I know Afro Resistance is raising money. Raising money for their projects that they pay for with their blood, literally.
No, what we're raising money for is, you know, there's a lot of Black folks here that look like us that don't only exist here. And because of COVID, the remittances that we have been sending to our families abroad have dried up. And the families abroad still are depending on that. So it's money for families like that. It's also for, there's a whole leap of young girls, Black young girls that are between 10 and 17 that are organizers. And they have projects that they're doing in their communities here in the Bronx, in Brooklyn, California, and they're from Latin America and they're doing really good projects. We want to help to fund them. So $50, $100 for little projects that these girls are doing. And then the third one is for women that have been disproportionately impacted by the criminal justice system from Latin America that are Black here. Because when you're an immigrant and you have it and you're not a citizen and you have gone through this criminal system and you're Black, none of these organizations want to even look at you. And this is what we were working on yesterday. The racialization and the anti-Blackness within the immigrant rights movement has us out here dry in the streets. So the little, you know, the monies that we're fundraising, the fund is really to support Black girls and women from Latin America and their families. So.
Yeah, I want to comment. Oh, go ahead, Angelique.
My comment, go ahead, baby, go ahead.
No, I just wanted to make a comment continuing off what John Vieff said about like Black immigrants, specifically Black immigrants from Latin America, are invisible in the United States. And I'm saying that from pure personal experiences, you know, going into these places and seeking immigration help and people like, and it's so subtle, but it speaks so much. Like, and this is Texas once again, right? So you'll go in there and they'll start speaking Spanish to everybody in there, but when they get to you, they want to change it into English. I spoke English in those instances, but it says so much about who is included and who's not included. And I know like that's a huge piece of tension right now with like Latinos in the United States and Black Lives Matter movement. It's like, well, what about the immigration system? What about when this happened? And it's like, again, when you say that, you make it seem like there cannot be any Black kids being treated violently in this by the immigration system. You make it seem like there are not any Black Mexican kids or Afro kids from any Central American place or other migrants that are experiencing those same harsh conditions and policies like everybody else. There you erase us. So again, until you recognize where Blackness is situated in your home country and how marginalized that is an identity and how that translates over borders, you still ain't talking about nothing. So at the end of the day, like, hasta la vida negra se importa, no vale nada. And that's inclusive of the immigration conversation. Inclusive of the immigration conversation. Because how does it mean? What are you to be? You're hyper-visible as a Black person, but invisible as a Latin person. Imagine that. Imagine that.
And I just want to quickly lift up the work of Javier. He's doing his PhD in sports, Afro-Latinos in sports. And the trend of these sports scouts of going to Latin America to recruit Black Latin Americans to bring to the U.S. to play sports. And then in some of those cases, leaving them high and dry, basically human trafficking. Leaving them high and dry, and then their status is in a flux.
And done by Latin Americans. Let that be known too, right? Because there's this idea, there's no racism in Latin America, but you sure found your way to Limon, Costa Rica, to Colón, Panama, and found some Black kids to come play basketball. So there's something about Blackness that you like and that's different from you.
You found all the MLB players. MLB players at San Pedro de Macorís in Dominican Republic, which is the baseball factory, essentially. You found all those baseball players in Cuba, and all the stories of defection from Cuba, and all of that life trajectory, and sports being one of the only ways of upward social mobility for Black Latin Americans, which is true in the U.S. as well. Sports being the avenue for upward mobility for African Americans. And so, like Javier always says, Latin America likes to tuck away and keep their Black people tucked away until it's time to win some shit. And that's in sports. That was in war. All these national teams are Black. All these Latin American national teams are Black and exclusively Black. El Choca Valley in Ecuador made up the soccer team that brought World Cups to Ecuador. But they didn't even have running water until an actual Black Ecuadorian player he built a hospital, he built a school, he built a pot of water. The same with Bambele in Colombia. When he won all these national boxing titles, they said, oh, what do you want? What do you want? You did all these extraordinary things. He says, I want running water for my community. Black people have to be extraordinary to get some running water. And this is the case in Cuba. I used to go to a gym that was pretty expensive by Cuban standards. All white Cubans, all of them. And then me and my husband, the only few Black people. And there was also another Black woman. And I said, oh, who is, there was a Black woman at the gym today to my husband. And he's like, oh, that's Mireia Luis. She won a few titles in the Olympics. She's a Black Cuban woman that went to the Olympics. She has to go to the Olympics to afford a gym membership with regular white Cubans.
But that's very similar. And you know, when you compare it to like US standards, I don't know if y'all remember when Chris Rock made that joke where he was talking about how him and Mary J. Blige and somebody else lived in the same neighborhood, but that his neighbor was like a dentist. So that like he had like, you know, had all the time. Right, and he had to have all this fame to be able to afford this particular neighborhood, but then his neighbor was like a dentist, like they was like, you know, regular white people, right, essentially. And so I think that it's a global thing where you have to be extraordinary to get basics, and they have to just is.
And did you have another? And I'm looking at the comments and no one is asking any questions except this one, how are class relations within the Afro-Latino community? Are Afro-Latinos concerned with the same issues as we are?
And I think I was looking at that question because I think class is a discussion that we have to unpack as we continue to do Afro movement work, Afro resistance work, because living in the DMV has been a fascinating education in class and class systems. And I have learned that as a poor immigrant, daughter of an immigrant from the hood in Brooklyn, that it is possible that the concerns are not always the same. But here's what I will say in reference to that question. People that are committed to the work and are committed to the work are committed to exhuming what, even if they come to the work from higher class systems, if you are committed to it, they are committed to exhuming the things that their class privilege gives them. But that doesn't mean that it is always done well. And that doesn't mean that it's always done with respect, right? And so I think that that's something that we really have to continue to unpack, is how class affects our interactions with each other and how class affects the movement work. Until we begin to unpack that, a lot of the work that we are actually trying to do intraculturally will not get done well, right? Because even down to accents and what are acceptable accents in Spanish are also deeply related to class. And I am very clear that as an educator, as a Spanish educator, as someone who teaches Spanish, I am very clear that because my accent is Central American and specifically Costa Rican, there is a level of, I guess, privilege.
Privilege.
And it is, and to be clear, it is frustrating, but I am also aware that in this Black ass body and in this Black ass plus size body and this Black ass bald head plus size body, that accent is the only thing that keeps the machetes from my throat. And so until we
deal with us. We're not real.
But it's a beautiful ballsy girl. Like, you got a little star. Can we see the star? Can you just?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, it's a slay. It's a slay.
You know, Santa is rude gal tingdem. I'm sorry, but I am committed to being a rude gal and a hot gal because they keep telling like bald-headed plus-size black girls that they're not supposed to be. So in every opportunity that I get to be rude gal behavior, sexy, whatever you want to call it, we gonna do it, bitch. Because
yeah. So the class analysis is extremely important because you have some people, as Evelyn said, and if you want to chime in, Evelyn says that you have people who were of the people. Then they gained their access into the middle class and white acceptance, which they value. And now all of a sudden racism is less. Now all of a sudden, you know, it's class, not race. When you were the ones, when no one asked to see your income or where you live before they pull you over. And so you have a lot of people who were of the people speaking for the people, and they're not for the people.
And Nancy has a question.
Okay.
Jeff, what happened to your hair? You said you liked it in a bun.
I took it down, girl. I took the connectalon down.
Wait, I do want to say that there is another question.
She did this and ran away.
Thank you.
There's another question in the chat about from Sasha.
As an Afro-Latina raised in DR, lifting the veil of anti-blackness for my life and re-educating myself, how can I show up for my black community now? How can I change the narrative of anti-Haitianism in my own family and community?
Yeah.
And what does black liberation look feel like to each of you, truly worldwide?
For Sasha, I want to refer her to Anabelica. Coming out of DR, I will find her name and I will send her because she is doing excellent work. That is the extent of the answer that I will give you because I do believe that Dominicans need to talk to Dominicans about certain things. And there are other people on the panel that may have something else to say, pero yo te voy a decir mi amor de mi corazón. There are things you gotta talk about to your kinfolk about. You also, and I wanna clarify this as well and stretch this out a little bit more. We all need to, especially those of us who are US-based or based abroad, need to be talking to back home to know what they have been doing, what has, and honoring that work already, because honoring that work means that we will be able to move forward and understanding what the context of the work is that we're doing here. But amor, I will find Anna's information for you and I will send it to you. Also, Manuel Mendez coming out of the DC Afro-Latino Caucus. Like, sometimes you gotta talk to your own about your own. And truth be told, I don't have much more to say about it aside from that.
Look at Afro Resistance page. We have a lot of stuff around the DR as well. We had Anna Balik in one of our talks recently. Check it out. And, you know, I honestly don't think that you need to put her in contact with Anna Balik. I think there's research that has to happen because Anna Balik is dealing with threats against her life.
I should say her work, not her.
Yeah. Yes.
Let's make that distinction. And she is. And so shout out for naming that because we also need to put the support behind the sis heart.
I agree with you. I'm not Dominican and I'm sure all of us know at least some of the context with the lengthy history of anti-blackness and anti-Haitianism and Trujillo and the Triqueño and Indio Oscuro and all of those lies. But in speaking about staying in our lanes, we gonna stay in our lane with this. You're gonna have to seek out your fam, your Dominican and Haitian fam to walk next to them. And by extension, all of us, but you know, we all have our nuances and context.
And in silence.
I also wanna add that like, that's a frequent question that we receive. Like, how do I like fix other people's anti-whateverness, particularly any type of anti-blackness. And I really think that you have to take that from a couple of different levels, right? Like, A, you gotta know your life. I'm very clear that you have to know your life, you have to know your people. If you get in sancocho from your grandma, that you have to be delicate with that conversation, right? Because that's a very real thing. But then conversely, also the idea that needing to fix other people is rooted in whiteness. That now I learned, so now I need to fix you, right? And while yes, there are conversations to be had, I think that ubicándose, right? Locating oneself is also locating where I think that I'm better because now I've discovered this. Like you discovered you was Black in 2019, you ain't gonna ask somebody who's been living since damn near 1919 to change their mind in 1 hour either, right? So you gotta have
why they have not been identifying, right? Because if you don't ask those, because like listen, the staff said it years ago, some of us armed ourselves in Blackness. We armed ourselves in it, right? And some of us could not. Right? And there are those are conversations that need to be had, but that doesn't mean that you need to lead it. Again, John Viev said it again, walk in silence. This work requires much more listening than it does speaking. You ain't changing your abuela. She been making that sancocho, how she been making it forever. But listen to what she has to say, because she might tell you some things about why she altered the way she said perejil, right? So that she could live. Y eso no tiene nada que ver conmigo. Right? That's abuela. And I want to highlight this because one of my old heads has always said, yo no soy jamaquina, yo no soy jamaquina, I'm not Jamaican. I'm like, sis, I'm not fighting with you. Okay, you're not Jamaican, we know. But like, let's not deny the Caribbean, like the Afro-Antillean roots that we have. And it wasn't until recently, it came up in another conversation. And listen, when you want to hear from the old heads, you actually have to be quiet because you have to let them speak. If you ask too much questions, they're not going to answer. But when you let them speak, you hear. My old head said to me, yeah, can you imagine? I was born in Costa Rica, third generation born in Costa Rica, and I had to apply for citizenship. So her resistance to calling herself Jamaican is rooted in the fact that as a third generation Costa Rican, she still had to apply for citizenship. This is my old head.
The trauma of it all.
And this is my old head who would not have volunteered this information if I just had not been listening. She said, I had to apply. So, okay, when I have conversations with her about this, about the anti-Blackness that is rooted in saying she is not Jamaican, I have a lens that is different, right? Because I'm like, okay, this is about your trauma. And so when I enter this space with you, I will enter it delicately. I will enter it with love. I will enter it with respect because you survived so that I could now thrive. Got it.
And a lot of these are defense mechanisms. We have to forgive our elders because they maneuvered the world how they felt they could survive. If it meant that they had to straighten their hair to get a job, that's what they were going to do. And that was what the conditions were during that time. And in some spaces, we can imagine more than that, but there are still some spaces where you could get harmed or killed for taking up your Blackness, for protesting, for speaking out. And so we have to forgive our elders in how they navigated the world because those are their only options. You know, we can't look at our grandmother and be like, oh, well, you stepped and fetched. No. Mm-mm. Your grandmother stepped and fetched so that you didn't have to. Let's get that straight. You know, we have this to honor our elders and to honor their struggle, to honor their pain. And a lot for a lot of people, it's very painful. It's very painful.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that that's something that we can commit to doing in the work of processing. Like we talked a little bit in another session that we had about how do we address things without seeming disloyal to what it is that we've learned, right? And I want to add that Dash added something that was really powerful in that we also need to show discernment into what it is that we want to continue to be loyal to. Yeah. What is it that you want to be disloyal to, right? And so in that way, we also want to recenter ourselves, right? And Ubicando says, like, stop trying to fix other people. Heal yourself. Do what it is that you need to do to be able to do the work of centering Black people or anything else. And just like, because that's exhausting also to try to feel like the lens is always outward. Like I always have to fix other people. I have to fix my grandma. I have to fix my uncle. I have to fix my, like, fix yourself and heal yourself.
Worry about yourself.
But yeah, worry about your food. Eat your food.
Hydrate and mind your damn business sometimes. Right.
So we have another question.
And they kind of all echoing each other.
Yeah, well, there's one that said, what does Black liberation look like for us? And how can light-skinned Black people better support and center dark-skinned Black folks when speaking about colorism? Well, that's easy. Center them. Center them. Be like, no, my homegirl, or even maybe you, not even your homegirl, someone that I know. Center. Fund.
Wait, and so you said fund. So I need to say this again. Shout out to Dash and to Evelyn, who have already supported me. I have been trying to create this Black joy graduation for my students, and I have been hitting railroads at every turn, in part because brown foolishness. So if anybody would like to support me, I am now looking for a space to hold this Black graduation in the midst of COVID. Hopefully I won't have to pay, but if anybody knows places in the DMV, preferably Maryland, preferably closer to PG County, please let me know. Or if anybody wants to donate some funds, I will drop my handle. Please bless a sis as she blesses the baby. Because, you know, a sis don't be out here asking for money for herself. She'd be asking for money for the baby. Although, if you want to bless me so I can get those hirachis that I've been looking at for the past 3 months and all this emotional labor and my pressure done went up, I will say thank you.
And a space for Angelique's students to graduate. And you've been doing that with your own resources.
Child, the hustle, And also, Okay.
I do want to honor Kylie Blocker's comment with, they said, heal ourselves and build up our youth so that they are better prepared. I am on that 100,000%. Like, definitely doing some internal work to really be reflective about our practices, to figure out, I say all the time, we have to Marie Kondo our thoughts, right? So if y'all watch the show on Netflix where she puts all the clothes on a bed and then she decides what brings joy and what doesn't, if you know that you got thoughts that are raggedy and they don't bring joy, let them go. Let them go. Retire them. Retire them and just and get you some new hirachis. Get you them new hot shit. Right? We are in choice. So the same way that we can make choices to continuously be there are portions of bias being choice, right? Because now people also, and also I would encourage people to not utilize learning as an oppressive tool where it's like, oh, I have to learn more so that now when I read all the books, that's when I'll stop being racist, or that's when I'll stop, you know, being anti-Black. Like, stop that shit today. Make a commitment. Make that change. Right, that was,
y'all here holding notes, sis. I'm here for it. Hey.
I want to continue off of what you said, Evelyn, to a question that I see here in the chat about somebody who's asking about anthropology, seemingly academia, and how can, like, they center Blackness? I think that's what I saw. And I think my continuation is exactly what Evelyn said. It's like, if you want to center Blackness within the work, that's what you need to do. Like, point blank and period. Like, that's what you need to do. I will say, because I've been introduced to so much scholarship stuff that I just read ridiculously so much. Like, one thing I would point you to that I use all the time, and, you know, I catch flack for it, but it allows me to speak my truth. I'm really drawn to, like, Patricia Hill Collins' Black feminist thought and Black woman's epistemology. I'm probably saying that word wrong. But that's a dope article. Because it allows you to think about why it's important for you to write, or Black people, and particularly Black women at that, in that article, to have to author their own stories. Because there's so many things they understand about the world that the white man tradition who has written about them ain't gonna be able to catch at all. So I think if you're looking for something you just gotta read today, I would pick that. Patricia Hill Collins, Black Feminist Thought, Black Woman's Epistemology. Again, I'm saying that wrong, but if you Google it,
that's how you say it.
Mm-hmm. That's how you say it.
Mm-hmm. You don't want to do the program, Javier.
No, let me tell you what somebody told me. They say, look, bro, you like a professor, you like a patio type professor. I said, what? You like you like a PhD that somebody uncle that talk on the patio. I'm like, you know what? Your ass out of here.
That's a compliment. That's a compliment, though.
Because the uncles on the patio have been out here sending me all the things on the WhatsApp to boil. And I've been boiling them. I got curcuma, I got jengibre, I got fiva grass. Look, I have boiled all of them.
Mom?
I'm not playing with the COVID. I'm not. And they still alive, so I'm listening.
That's what practices. Nigel asked, how do you see the Black struggle for self-education and experience going on in North Central and South America and the Caribbean? We've always ongoingly been, come on, y'all. I'm sorry, I'm getting a little offended by this because I am very tired of people in the US claiming to say that our Black Latin American awakening is new. We've been at this since 1492, my guy, okay? We have been going at this for 500 years, B.
Yo, let me hit something.
We have been doing the revolts. We have been doing the movements. We have been doing the Black theater. We have been doing the Black books. We have been doing the Black Congress.
Yo, let me hit something real quick, though. Let me hit something real quick. And I might get in trouble for it, but we about to end anyway. Yo, some of the voices that are being amplified right now are coming out of spaces that have just figured out they're Black. But listen, you need to get into some other literature. You need to not just watch, like, IG, you need to get into some other.
We cannot watch Henry Louis Gates because we need to center our own voices for ourselves.
Right. Like, look, some of what you're hearing, and also, look. I'm about to get in trouble. I know that some of us want to co-opt the word Black. Look, everybody on this panel been Black, and we've been Black in every language. So, like, we're not new to this. The work that you were talking, the questions that you were asking, the work that you were at there, you were asking about, have been happening in the Caribbean and Central America. And I want to do this real quick.
In South America.
And South America. Thank you. Caribbean. Because a lot of scholarship that we need as a diaspora to heal is there. A lot of what we lost was lost there. And so we sometimes in our efforts to understand global Blackness, we skip over the Caribbean. The Caribbean does not just have dancehall to offer you. Like, but shout, but also I want you to watch how dancehall was the precursor to George Floyd. How dancehall had us all talking to each other already. We were already talking to each other about Beanie Man, but we were already, so this global movement has always been happening because we have always been talking to each other. Now, is it possible that US-centered Blackness has not been talking with us for the past 30 years? It's possible, I don't know. But I think it's important that you get into the literature of the Caribbean, Central, and South America because we are not new to this.
And the thing is, the biggest resource for Black and Afro-descended and African resources is named after a Black Puerto Rican man, okay? The Schomburg Center, Arturo Schomburg, was an Afro-Puerto Rican man who was part of the Masons, who actually, he was integral in the liberation movements in Cuba with other Black Cubans in New York, in Harlem. Machito and his Afro-Cubans, Mario Bausa, was BFFs with Dizzy Gillespie. He discovered Ella Fitzgerald. We have always been communicating with one another. Langston Hughes was BFFs with Black Cuban Nicolás Guillén. Abdio de Nascimento went to Peru and he saw blackface and he went back to Brazil and made the Black experimental theater in the 40s. Come on, y'all. And I'm not shaming anyone for not knowing things, but let's get out of this habit of parroting that Black Latin Americans didn't know that they were Black. Cut it out.
And you know, and folks have to understand that slavery happened in Latin America. And if we didn't know we were Black, we would still be slaves. Like, we didn't wait for slavery in the United States. You know, like, we didn't wait for that to happen. We didn't wait for Harriet Tubman over here to then come and go from country to country and help us out. Like, there's slavery
votes that were happening. Everybody tight. Everybody, like, lean to the side and look. Look.
We really are.
Yeah, we were all in the same, because, like, listen, we about to get on this Zoom and hit a drink together, like, look, because uno don't want to listen, fuck our own.
No, I just don't understand when people forget that we have been in Latin America, And people forget that we have an actual lived experience in Latin America. And people that are decision makers.
Yeah, yeah.
Foundations, academia, institutions, education, all these structures that dictate quality of life for people and human beings. Decision makers don't know, a lot of decision makers don't know that slavery happened in Latin America as well. So then, of course, if that's the starting point that you don't even know that that existed, imagine our lack of humanity.
And it was on a mass scale in Latin America before it was in the U.S. Let's make that clear, too.
That's
Diaspora 101. We're not going to waste any more time with that. We are going to, we got to wrap up, guys. And we're going on 2 hours. This is only supposed to be an hour. Like, you see the sobremesa, you see the kitchen talk that we engage in. Like, look, entre familia, right?
Radio Peña Negra, though we do our lives too. Afrolatino yeah. Towel does lives too.
So yeah. Just a closing thoughts. Radio Caña Negra, follow us. We do workshops and about anti-blackness in the Latino community. I have a docuseries called Negro, a docuseries about Latinx identity.
And how old is it? How old is Negro?
Negro is 9 years old.
What? Oh, I thought it was like produced like 2 months ago when you found out about Black people.
Fernando just interviewed me about my 9-year-old documentary.
Yeah. And it's awesome. Walking around with thoughts of their own, 9 years old.
It's a child. It's a preteen. At this point, if you'd like to view it, it's negrodoc.com. Hit us up. I'll give you access to the 2-hour documentary. There's 30 video shorts. Evelyn Rightness at Rightness, Angeli at La Negra Speaks, Javier at FAMU 512. FAMU 512?
512.
John VF, Afro Resistance, JW Panama. Last comments to wrap it up, and we're out of here.
I love Black people. I love Afro descendants. We're amazing. We're lit. I can't live without y'all. So I love you. Real shit.
I'm Black, Black, Black today, Black when I was born, Black tomorrow, will be Black. Love Black food, including the pictures, even if I can't eat them. Love my lipstick. Look at that.
Yes, bitch!
Is that Boss Lady? That's Boss Lady.
And that is Rightness right here, providing that. So
but your big lips that are amazing. Yes.
So I'm just in love right now. Yeah. So peace.
Appreciate it. That's it. I don't appreciate y'all.
Y'all come back now. You hear?
That's about it. Appreciate y'all.
I don't even know what that was,
Dash. I know, because I'm obsessed with Southern now.
Yo, Javier, I'm trying to be a UT, so let's talk.
Well, ain't nobody going to be a UT in the fall, but let's talk.
I mean, right. Después del COVID, no, pero...
EVE, la repartera supreme.
I just want to say thank you so much for including me in this conversation. Shout out to everybody that's in the comments telling us, giving us some thoughts. Thank you, Dash, for your powerful moderation. How much I love my fellow macheteras on the panel, right? Baby bro, Javier. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Please stay in touch and, you know, drop some coins into all of these amazing programs that are happening so that we can continue to do this work, so we can continue to have these conversations. And I also want to encourage people from reframing conversations about Blackness as difficult. They are not difficult. They are conversations just like any other. I think that that also frames the narrative that somehow these conversations are like, oh, my God, I'm so hard. We're about to have a difficult conversation. Conversations about race ain't difficult. Conversations about the raggedy ass shit that racism does is difficult, right? Let's be very clear. So thanks.
Yeah. Subscribe to our podcast, Radio Caña Negra. And I think that's it. Again, Afro means Black. Afro means Black.
That's it.
Thank you, Anna. Thank you, Afro Latina. And we'll see you next time.
Bye.